So today we will look into finding the pressure from the first Pavlov-Kirchhoff or the second Pavlov-Kirchhoff stress tensor. Although this is not essential for compressible hyperelasticity, however, for incompressible hyperelasticity, these expressions will be helpful. For the sake of completeness, we will look into how to determine pressure. Okay? So, we have already seen the true deviatoric stress components of first Pavlov-Kirchhoff and second Pavlov-Kirchhoff stress tensor. Okay? So, now to determine the hydrostatic pressure P, we have to start from taking the double contraction, say for example, of the first Pavlov-Kirchhoff stress tensor with the deformation gradient tensor, or the second Pavlov-Kirchhoff stress tensor with the right Cauchy green tensor C. Okay? So, the decomposition of the first Pavlov-Kirchhoff stress tensor is given by P equal to the deviatoric part P dash plus P into I F inverse transverse. Okay? So, this should be J. Okay? Now, if we take double contraction with the deformation gradient tensor on both the sides. Okay? So, this is double contraction we have taken from both the sides. Okay? So, this is what we get. Okay? Now, we already have shown, okay, that P dash, okay, so the deviatoric part of the first Pavlov-Kirchhoff stress tensor when double contracted with the deformation gradient tensor is equal to 0. Okay. And then this first term on the right hand side is 0, and if I look into this term, okay, this is nothing but A double contraction with B, which is written as trace of A transpose B. Okay. Now, so my A I can identify as F inverse transpose and B as F. So, I can write P J transpose of F inverse transpose F, okay, which is nothing but equal to P J trace of F inverse F. Now, what is F inverse F? It is equal to identity, okay, and then I get P J trace of identity, which is nothing but equal to 3. Okay? So, from here I can determine the pressure as 1 by 3 J inverse the first Pavlov-Kirchhoff stress tensor double contracted with the deformation gradient tensor F. Okay? So, similarly, one can take the double contraction with the right Cauchy green tensor, okay, of the second Pavlov-Kirchhoff stress tensor, and then you can obtain the hydrostatic pressure P as 1 by 3 J inverse S contracted with C. Okay? So, that is how you can determine the hydrostatic pressure. Okay? So, this is, as I said earlier, will be helpful when you are dealing with incompressible hyperelasticity. Okay? But in this course, because we consider only compressible hyperelasticity, this will not be of much use. But for the sake of completeness, we have derived these expressions. Okay? So, next we move to our important topic of objective stress measures. Okay? So, when we are discussing objectivity, we had defined an objective tensor S as one which under the superimposed rigid body motion transforms according to the following equation. And what is this equation? This is S tilde is equal to Qs Q transpose, where Q is the superimposed rigid body motion. Okay? Now, also we had shown that the Cauchy stress tensor was indeed an objective tensor, and then it transformed according to the relation given by equation number 154, which is sigma tilde is Q sigma Q transpose. Now, let us take the derivative of equation 154 with respect to time, that is we take material time derivative. Let us see what happens. Okay. Now, if you take the material time derivative of equation 154, on the right hand side we have sigma tilde dot, and then we have Q dot sigma Q transpose plus Q sigma dot Q transpose plus Q sigma Q dot transpose. We can clearly see that this expression, okay, is not equal to, okay. So, the material time derivative or sigma tilde is not equal to Q sigma dot Q transpose. So, we have two additional terms, this first term and this is the third term. So, because of the presence of these two terms, the material rate of the Cauchy stress tensor, okay, so which is sigma dot, okay, that is the material rate of the Cauchy stress tensor is not an objective tensor, or it is not an objective quantity. Okay. If it was an indeed an objective quantity, it would have transformed according to relation which is given here, but did not. Okay. So, Cauchy stress tensor is an objective tensor, however, its rate is not an objective tensor. Okay. And now, this has consequence when we are dealing with rate dependent materials. Okay. So, the constitutive response of many rate dependent materials are defined in terms of the stress rate and strain rates. For example, the rate of deformation tensor. Okay. So, if you have a rate dependent material, its response to the external loads, okay, over time will be expressed, okay, in terms of stress rates and strain rate, for example, rate of deformation tensor. Okay. And we know that Cauchy stress is the true stress. So, its rate, okay, we have to use for the constitutive response, but we also have seen from the previous slide that the rate of Cauchy stress is not objective. So, there will be dependence on the material frame. So, if there is superimposed rigid body motion, then there will be some spurious increment in the stresses just because of rigid body motion, which should not happen. Okay. So, now we have to deal with this situation. Okay. So, the constitutive models and the response these models generate must therefore be frame indifferent. Okay. So, whatever response we are getting for these rate dependent materials, they must be frame indifferent. They should not depend on the frame. So, what to do? Which means that stress rates should not depend on the frame of reference. Okay. So, since the response has to be frame indifferent, therefore, the stress rates that we should use should also not depend on the frame of reference, or they should also be frame indifferent. Okay. That is what I have written here, that the stress rates should be frame indifferent. Okay. So, it is essential. So, when stress rates are frame indifferent, this means that stress rates have to be objective. So, consequence of this is our stress rates that we use in the constitutive response, they should be objective. Okay. And it is essential that we derive stress rate measures that are objective. Okay. So, our stress rate that we have seen here, the rate of Cauchy stress is not objective. Therefore, we should come up with some stress rates which are objective. Okay. And important point to note here is that the stress and strain measures are material quantities. Okay. If your stress and strain measures are material quantities, then the objectivity is automatically satisfied. That we saw that the second Pyle-Kirchhoff stress tensor and the Green-Lagrange strain tensor S and E were indeed objective. Okay. So, we had seen that S tilde was equal to S and E tilde came out to be same as E. Okay. So, they are indifferent to the rigid body, superimposed rigid body motion. Okay. And then these stress and strain measures will be energy conjugate. However, if the quantities are spatial, okay. Now, if the strain and stress measures that you use are spatial quantities like Cauchy stress, okay, and the rate of deformation tensor, then the objectivity of the stress rate is not guaranteed. Okay. Even if the strain rate is objective, which means for an R case, D for example was an objective quantity. Okay. So, D tilde was Q D Q transpose. Okay. So, the strain rate is objective, but we know that the Cauchy rate of Cauchy stress is not objective. Okay. And we also know that the Cauchy stress is work conjugate with the rate of deformation tensor. So, we now have to come up with some stress rate measure which are objective, so that we do not have any effect or any increment in the stress when there is only superimposed rigid body motion. Okay. So, there are two ways in which the objective stress rates can be derived. In the first way, we have the tensorial coordinate transformation method, and this is usually followed in standard nonlinear finite element textbook. Okay. For example, you can see the nonlinear finite element procedures book by Belichko, Liu and Moran. Okay. And these kind of procedure, they provide very informative and geometrical insight. Okay. You can get a lot of information and geometrical insight. And the second procedure is through variational principles, okay, from the strain energy density in the material, okay, which is expressed in terms of strain tensor, which is objective by its definition. Okay. So, you can express the strain energy density, say for in terms of rate of deformation tensor, which it indeed is objective. Therefore, if you use variational principles, you will get a stress measure which is objective. But this is very mathematically involved, but it automatically ensures energy conservation, that is the work conjugacy requirement. Okay. You will see that in the first approach, the work conjugacy requirement is not entirely fulfilled. However, but in the second, this is automatically fulfilled. Okay. Now, in the present course, okay, because this is not a full course on continuum mechanics, we only look into some of the objective stress measures which are derived using the first approach, which is the tensorial coordinate transformation. Okay. So, in the present course, we follow the first procedure. Okay. And there are numerous objective stress rates in continuum mechanics, and therefore, all of which can be shown to be a special form of Lie derivatives. So, if you remember, what were Lie derivative? Lie derivative was you wanted to find the rate of a certain quantity, okay, which is spatial. Okay. So, if you wanted to compute the rate of a certain spatial quantity, what you did was first you pulled back that quantity to the material configuration, you took the material time derivative, and then you pushed forward this time derivative to the spatial configuration to get the rate of that particular quantity. Okay. So, if you remember, the rate of deformation tensor was nothing but the, you pulled back the Euler-Lemanczyk strain tensor to the material configuration, where it became the Green-Lagrange strain tensor. You took the material time derivative and then you pushed it back to the spatial configuration to get the rate of deformation tensor. Okay. So, all these objective stress rates, okay, can be shown as a special form of Lie derivatives. And in this course, we just go very superficially. We do not go much deeper because this is much more a plate course. Okay. So, some of the most widely used objective stress measures are the Truesdell stress rate, the Alderoid stress rate, the convective stress rate, Green-Nagy stress rate, and Zaremba-Zoman stress rate. Okay. So, some of these stress rate, for example, Green-Nagy and Zaremba-Zoman stress rates are used in commercial finite element packages. And towards the end of this lecture, we will briefly touch upon some of the recent studies which have been done on these stress measures and certain suggestions that people have been recommending for last say 5-6 years. Okay. So, first we look into what is called the Truesdell stress rate. Now, the Truesdell stress rate is the most simplest of all the objective stress rates, and it is based on the fact that the second Pyla-Kirchhoff stress tensor is independent of any rigid body motion, which means S tilde is equal to S. This we had already shown when we were discussing the effect of superimposed rigid body motion on the second Pyla-Kirchhoff stress tensor, and we ensure that S tilde will come out to be equal to S. Okay. Now, this stress rate is denoted by sigma, and there is a superscript with a small circle, let us say sigma 0. Okay. And it is defined in terms of the Pyla transformation of the time derivative of second Pyla-Kirchhoff stress tensor as sigma 0 is J inverse, okay, push forward of the material time derivative of the second Pyla-Kirchhoff stress tensor. Okay. So, we already had studied the Pyla transformation of the Green Lagrange, this second Pyla-Kirchhoff stress tensor. So, the Truesdell stress rate is defined as the Pyla transformation of the time derivative of second Pyla-Kirchhoff stress tensor, and this is how it is defined. Okay. So, this means S dot is the material time derivative of the second Pyla-Kirchhoff stress tensor, and then we know that S is equal to, so this is your second Pyla-Kirchhoff stress tensor, and this you can write in terms of the Cauchy stress tensor, which is J F inverse sigma F inverse transpose. Okay. And then the push forward, so this push forward operation will be nothing but the term in the bracket is pre-multiplied by the deformation gradient tensor and post-multiplied by the transpose of the deformation gradient tensor. Okay. Now, let us see what does this expression give. Let us simplify this, okay, and see what expression for sigma 0 or the Truesdell stress rate we end up with. Okay. So, now, if you take the material time derivative, okay, of the terms inside the brackets. Okay. So, what we get J inverse F and then J dot F inverse sigma F inverse transpose, that is because the term inside the bracket had 4 terms, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So, first J dot F inverse sigma F inverse transpose, then J F dot inverse sigma F inverse transpose, plus J F inverse sigma dot F inverse transpose, plus J F inverse sigma F dot inverse transpose, and then multiplied by F transpose. Okay. Now, let us simplify it further. Okay. Now, I can take F inside the bracket and F transpose also inside the bracket. Okay. So, this F, I get J dot F F inverse sigma F inverse transpose, then you have the, similarly you have the second term, third term and the fourth term. Now, I know that F F inverse is identity, and if I take transpose of this, I get F inverse transpose F transpose also as identity. Okay. So, I can see here I have one F, F inverse, okay, and I have F inverse transpose F transpose. Okay. So, I have F inverse transpose F transpose, I have F, F inverse, F inverse transpose F transpose, I have F, F inverse. Okay. So, there are total of 6 terms which I can make identity. Okay. So, I put identity in this circle terms, and then what I get as the Truesdell rate is equal to J inverse J dot sigma plus J F F dot inverse sigma plus J sigma dot plus J sigma F dot inverse transpose F transpose. Okay. Now, let us see whether we can simplify it bit further. So, we know from our discussion on the material time derivative of the Jacobian that we can show that the material time derivative of the Jacobian is nothing but equal to J times trace of the velocity gradient tensor L. Okay. So, if this is the case, then I can write this J dot here as J times trace of velocity gradient times sigma, and the other 3 terms remain same. Now, I have J inverse outside the bracket and I have J in each of the 4 terms which are inside the bracket. So, I can just multiply by J inverse on all the terms which are inside the bracket. Okay. So, moving the Jacobian inside the bracket will give me the Truesdell rate as trace of velocity gradient times sigma plus F F dot inverse sigma plus sigma dot sigma F dot inverse transpose F transpose. Okay. Now, this third term here is the rate of Cauchy stress, okay, which is not objective. Okay. And till now, I have still not shown that Truesdell rate is objective. Okay. We are first deriving the expression for Truesdell rate, and then later on we will show that it is indeed an objective tensor. Okay. So, now what we do? Okay. We can compute the material time derivative of F inverse. Okay. How can you compute? We know that F F inverse is identity. So, if I take the material time derivative on both the sides, okay, what I can do is the material time derivative of F F inverse is the material time derivative of identity, which is nothing but equal to 0. And then I can write, so the left hand side is F dot F inverse plus F F dot inverse equal to 0. Okay. Now, I can use the fact that the material time derivative of F, which is F dot, is related to the velocity gradient tensor L as F dot equal to Lf. Okay. So, if I substitute F dot as Lf here, I get Lf F inverse F F dot inverse equal to 0, okay, which means because F F inverse is identity, I can get L plus F F dot inverse equal to 0. And then I can get the inverse of the material time derivative of the deformation gradient tensor as minus of F inverse times velocity gradient tensor L. So, this now I can substitute. Okay. So, I can compute the transpose also, and now this I can substitute in my expression on the previous slide. Okay. And I can get trace of velocity gradient times the Cauchy stress tensor minus F F inverse L sigma plus sigma dot. Okay. Minus sigma L transpose F inverse transpose F transpose. Now, again F F inverse is identity, and also F inverse transpose F transpose is nothing but again its identity. Okay. So, I can get the Truesdell stress rate as, so this is the Truesdell stress rate is nothing but the rate of Cauchy stress minus sigma L transpose plus trace of L into sigma. Okay. So, this is the Truesdell stress rate, and we claim right now that it is an objective measure, okay, which means sigma 0 is independent of the frame of reference, or it is frame indifferent. Okay. So, now let us show that Truesdell stress rate is an objective tensor. Okay. So, when we say I have to show a certain quantity, okay, say a second order tensor is an objective tensor, what I mean is under superimposed rigid body motion Q, the tensor should transform according to S tilde is Q S Q transpose. Okay. So, this means that the Truesdell stress rate should transform according to following relation, which is given by equation 160 under rigid body motion. Okay. So, what we do first is we begin by writing equation 159 in the rotated configuration. Okay. So, we just put a tilde over our previous expression. So, our expression was sigma 0 equal to sigma dot minus L sigma minus sigma tilde L tilde transpose plus trace of L tilde sigma tilde. Okay. Now, I can, okay, sorry, this is not tilde. So, this is the expression for the Truesdell stress rate, and now under superimposed rigid body motion, let equation 161 give you the Truesdell stress rate. Okay. Now, we had earlier shown that the Cauchy stress under rigid body motion transforms according to relation Q sigma Q transpose. Okay. And remember, Q is orthogonal, which means Q Q transpose equal to identity, or Q transpose Q is equal to identity. Okay. Which means, and also we have shown that the material time derivative of the Cauchy stress tensor is Q dot sigma Q transpose plus Q sigma dot Q transpose plus Q sigma Q dot transpose. Okay. And if you remember from our discussion on objectivity that the velocity gradient tensor in the after applying the superimposed rigid body motion was given by QL Q transpose plus Q dot Q transpose. So, we had shown that L, the velocity gradient tensor L, is not an objective quantity because of the presence of this term. However, we just recapitulate this equation. Okay. Now, if you see all these equations 162, 163, 164, we can just substitute the left hand side in terms of the right hand side in equation 161. Okay, and that is what we are going to do. Okay. So, L tilde transpose, just take the transpose of this, and now we have to just substitute all these four here. Okay. So, not to cause the clutter of writing a very long expression, let us first calculate L tilde sigma tilde. Okay. So, L tilde is QL Q transpose plus Q dot Q transpose into sigma tilde is Q sigma Q transpose. Now, I can open up the bracket. Okay. I can take Q sigma Q transpose inside the bracket and multiply by both the terms, and I get QL Q transpose Q sigma Q transpose plus Q dot Q transpose Q sigma Q transpose. Okay. And I know that Q transpose Q is identity because Q is an objective tensor. Therefore, this quantity over here is equal to identity. Okay. And then I get L tilde sigma tilde as q L q transpose plus q dot sigma q transpose. Okay. Similarly, I can compute sigma tilde L tilde transpose, which is q sigma q transpose plus q L transpose plus q q dot transpose. Okay. If we simplify, what we get? Sigma tilde L tilde transpose as q sigma L transpose plus q sigma q dot transpose. Okay. Once we have this, and also just to mention that trace of L, it is a scalar quantity. Therefore, trace of L will be same as trace of L tilde, because trace of L itself is a scalar quantity, and scalar quantities have no effect of rigid body motion, therefore superimposed rigid body motion. So, trace of L will be same as trace of sigma tilde. Okay. So, if we substitute equation 166 and 167 in equation 161, what we get? So, this is your equation 161. So, this implies that the Troostel stress rate after rigid body, superimposed rigid body motion, will be q dot sigma q transpose plus q sigma dot q transpose plus q sigma q dot transpose minus q L sigma q transpose minus q dot sigma q transpose minus q sigma L transpose minus q sigma q dot transpose plus trace of L sigma tilde, where I have used the fact that trace of L is same as trace of L tilde, because it is a scalar quantity. Okay. And now, we notice that this term cancels out with this term. Okay. So, this is a positive, this is a negative term. So, these two terms cancel out, and the third term and this term over here, they also cancel out. Okay. So, these four terms cancel out, and what I am left with is the Troostel stress rate after superimposed rigid body motion is given by q sigma dot q transpose minus q L sigma q transpose minus q sigma L transpose plus trace of L, and sigma tilde is q sigma q transpose. Okay. Now, if I look closely on the left hand side, I always have q. Okay. The leftmost term on each subterm is q, and the rightmost term, okay, in each subterm is q transpose. Okay. So, I can take q outside the bracket, okay, from all the terms on the left hand side, and this q transpose I can take out from the right hand side, and what I get? I get the Troostel stress rate after superimposed rigid body motion as q times sigma dot minus sigma L transpose plus trace of L sigma into q transpose. And I can immediately identify that this term inside the bracket, okay, is nothing but the Troostel stress rate, okay, before the superimposed rigid body motions were applied. Therefore, if I substitute it here, I get the Troostel stress rate after superimposed rigid body motion is equal to q times the Troostel stress rate into q transpose. Okay. And we see that this relation is a relation which has to be satisfied by any second order tensor, which has to be an objective tensor. Therefore, we can say now that the Troostel stress rate is an objective tensor. Okay. So, we have derived one of the objective stress measure, which is the Troostel stress rate. We have derived this expression, and also now we have shown that indeed the Troostel stress rate is an objective quantity. Okay. So, there will be no effect of superimposed rigid body motion. Okay. So, now we look into some more details about the Truesdell stress rate tensor. So, the Truesdell stress rate tensor can be interpreted in terms of the Lie derivative of the Kirchhoff stress. Okay. So, Kirchhoff stress is tau. Okay. Now, the J times Truesdell stress rate is the Lie derivative over the current deformation of the Kirchhoff stress, okay, which means here I can write J sigma 0 as tau 0. Therefore, tau 0 is the Lie derivative of the Kirchhoff stress tau, okay, where this Lie derivative explicitly is carried out like this. Okay, tau 0 is push forward of the material time derivative of the pull back of the Kirchhoff stress tensor. Okay. So, this is the pull back, this is the material time derivative, and this is the push forward. Okay. Okay. So, the Truesdell stress rate, okay, can be treated as a Lie derivative of the Kirchhoff stresses. Okay. So, here the second parallel Kirchhoff stress tensor we know is nothing but the pullback of the Kirchhoff stress tensor, which is explicitly written as F inverse tau F inverse transpose. Okay. Now, if I can put it here, I can put this here, and then tau 0 is the push forward of the material time derivative of the second parallel Kirchhoff stress tensor, explicitly F S dot F transpose. Okay. So, and S dot is nothing but d by dt of F inverse tau F inverse transpose and then F transpose. Okay. So, if we follow a similar process that we did for the Cauchy stress tensor, we can also show that the Truesdell rate of the Kirchhoff stress tensor. Okay. So, earlier we derived the Truesdell rate of the Cauchy stress tensor sigma 0. Now, if we follow a similar procedure, we can show that the Truesdell rate of the Kirchhoff stress tensor tau 0 is given by the material time derivative of the Kirchhoff stress tensor minus L tau minus tau L transpose. Okay. So, this you can show. Okay. So, now let us move on to some other stress measures, because Truesdell stress measure is not the only objective stress measure. There are some other types, and the first one is the Alderoid stress rate. This is another stress measure. And if this can be derived, okay, so this is denoted by this symbol, and this can be derived in terms of the Lie derivative of the Cauchy stress tensor. So, this is the Alderoid stress rate is nothing but the Lie derivative of the Cauchy stress tensor. Okay. So, what it means is you pull back the Cauchy stress tensor in the material configuration, take the material time derivative. So, this is a pullback. Okay, to the material configuration, then you take the material time derivative and then you finally push it forward. So, this is the push forward. So, first you do the pullback, you carry out this material time derivative and then you push forward to the spatial configuration to get the Alderoid stress rate. Okay. So, the pullback is F inverse sigma F inverse transpose. And then push forward, then you have the material time derivative. The push forward is F times the material time derivative of the pullback of sigma times F transpose. And if you carry out, so in Truesdell rate, we have already shown how to compute, okay, these kind of expressions. So, okay, all you need to do now is take the material time derivative inside. So, you will have 3 terms, and then you do a similar procedure that we did for the Truesdell stress rate, and then finally, you will arrive at the following expression for the Alderoid stress rate, which is given by equation 170. Okay. So, the next rate is the convective stress rate. Okay. So, if we carry out the pullback and the push forward operations with F transpose, F inverse transpose, okay, in the previous, in the Alderoid, instead of the usual, we do it with F transpose, F inverse transpose, then we get an objective stress rate tensor, which is called the convective stress rate, and this is the expression. And if you carry out this operation, okay, so if you just do these operations, what you will get is the following expression, which is given in equation 171, and this is called the convective stress rate. Okay. The next one is the Green-Nagy stress rate. It is used widely in many of the commercial packages. Okay. And now, in this convective stress rate, if this rate, the stretch component of the deformation gradient tensor F is ignored, which means that if you take the deformation gradient tensor is nearly equal to the rotation tensor R, orthogonal rotation tensor R, then we get what is called the Green-Nagy stress rate. Okay. So, in Green-Nagy stress rate, the pullback and the push forward operations are performed using the rotation tensor R. Okay. So, here F is taken as R, therefore, F inverse is R inverse, which is nothing but R transpose, and F inverse transpose will be nothing but R. Okay. So, F inverse transpose gets replaced by R, F inverse gets replaced by R transpose, and F transpose is R transpose, and F is R. Okay. So, that is what we have. So, in the convective stress rate, if you have, I mean, instead of going with the pullback and push forward by F transpose, F inverse transpose, we take the pullback and the push forward using the rotation tensor R, then what we get is the Green-Nagy stress rate, which is shown in equation 172. And if you do the simplification, this is left as a trivial exercise. I mean, you just have to take the carry out the derivatives and put it there. You get the Green-Nagy stress rate as sigma dot plus sigma R dot R transpose minus R dot R transpose sigma. Okay. This is called the Green-Nagy stress rate. And the another and the last one that we consider in this course is the Zaremba-Zoman stress rate. This again is used in many commercial packages. Okay. So, here what you do, if in the Green-Nagy stress rate, the anti-symmetric tensor is approximated by the spin tensor W. Okay. So, we had shown that omega is R dot R transpose. Okay. If omega was R dot R transpose, okay, you can see R dot R transpose we have, and under special condition we had derived that under rigid body motion omega is same as R dot R transpose. This we had derived when we were discussing why omega is called the spin tensor. Okay. If you recall that, then omega replaces R dot R transpose, and then the rate that we get is called the Zaremba-Zoman stress rate given by equation 173. Okay. So, these are the 5 different stress rates that are commonly used. Okay. Now, the important point to note again is that irrespective of the approximations made to derive the Green-Nagy or the Zaremba-Zoman stress rate, that is equation 172 and 173, both will remain objective even when these approximations do not apply. In Green-Nagy, we had F was nearly equal to R, and in the second one, we approximated omega as R dot R transpose. Okay. If you remember, we derived omega equal to R dot R transpose only when we considered that there is rigid body motion. if there was no rigid body motion, there were some extra terms after r dot r transpose. So, here what we have taken is omega is r dot r transpose. So, both these approximations, even if they do not apply, even then the Green-Nagy stress rate and the Zaremba-Zaman stress rate will remain objective, okay, and this you can show, okay. So, now let us show that the Zaremba-Zaman stress rate is objective, okay, and now I will not detail out the expressions, okay, but I will give you the steps and you can carry out this operations and get the desired result. So, what we want to show is the Zaremba-Zaman stress rate after the superimposed rigid body motion is given by Q times the Zaman stress rate times Q transpose. Okay. So, how do we show? The first step is you express the Zaremba-Zaman stress rate by following expression. Okay. So, what you do? You just take the expression for Zaremba-Zaman and just put a tilde over each term. Okay. Once you have this, the first term sigma tilde dot, okay, we already have derived. Okay, this is the material rate of the Cauchy stress tensor, this we already have derived. And to get omega tilde, okay, omega tilde is 1 by 2 L tilde plus L tilde transpose. Okay. So, L tilde is QL transpose Q dot plus Q dot Q transpose, L tilde transpose is QL transpose Q transpose plus Q Q dot transpose. Okay. Therefore, in step 3, I can compute omega tilde, which is the symmetric part of the velocity gradient tensor, and then I can compute omega tilde using these two expression for the velocity gradient tensor, okay, after superimposed rigid body motion. Once I have calculated this, I can substitute omega tilde from step 3 and sigma tilde dot from step 2 in this expression over here. Okay, I can substitute it here and then finally, I will come to this expression. Okay, and then this term inside, I can identify it as the Zaman stress rate. Okay, so I will be able to show that the Zaremba-Zaman stress rate is indeed an objective tensor. Okay, so this I leave it to you as an exercise. Okay, you can follow these four steps. It's very easy to show. Okay, there'll be long expressions, but you can, and all everywhere you just use this condition that Q Q transpose equal to identity, or Q transpose Q is equal to identity. Okay. So, using similar procedures, you can show that the Aldoroid stress rate, the convective stress rate and the Green-Nagy stress rate are all objective quantities. Okay. And this is left for you as an exercise. Okay. And very easy to show for all these quantities, okay, except for Green-Nagy, where you have to use the fact that RR transpose is identity. So, to get R dot, you have to take the material time derivative of RR transpose is identity, and then from there you derive R dot. Okay? That is the only hint. The other two are very simple to do. The third one, this particular help that I am giving you, you can use. Okay? So, finally, we come to the last part of this module on kinetics, okay, which is the some of the observation or some of the work that I think you guys should know. Okay. So, there are in large some 10 years a lot of papers have come, a lot of literature has come which discusses what are the implications of various objective stress measures in commercial finite element codes. Say for example, when I looked into the Abacus 6.6 manual, which is available online, okay, there what they say is that if you are using Abaguts standard, which means the implicit Abacus, okay, And if you choose a solid element which is continuum, okay, like you use 8 noded brick element which is a solid element, and if you choose a constitutive model which is all inbuilt models which are there in Abacus or any user defined material model, then the objective stress rate they will use is the Zaremba-Zaumann or simply the Zaumann stress rate. Okay. If you use any structural elements like shells, membranes, beams and stresses, the Green-Nagy stress rate is used. Okay. On the other hand, if you are using Abacus explicit where no Newton-Raphson method is used for the solution, okay, for example, in high velocity impact fracture kind of problems, then for solid elements, okay, for all material models except viscoelastic, brittle, cracking and in view mat, okay, except for all these three cases, they use Zaumann. Okay. For solid continuum, for viscoelastic, brittle cracking and in the view mat subroutine, the Green-Nagy stress rate is used. Okay. And for structural elements like shells, membranes, beams and trusses, for all inbuilt and user defined materials, the Green-Nagy stress rate is used. Okay. So, you can see Abacus as per version 6.6, there are current versions also. So, but what I am stating is in the previous version, they use either Zaumann or the Green-Nagy stress rate. Okay. So, you can check in the current manual of Abacus what kind of stress measure are being used. Okay. Now, as I said, there have been some studies on how these stress measures cause problem in certain kind of simulation. For example, Baza and co-authors, they studied the work conjugacy error in commercial finite element codes. Okay. They quantified its magnitude, that is the error of work conjugacy, and they suggested ways to compensate for it. Okay. And they through examples have shown that there can be an error of 15% to 28% in the polymeric foam core if you use the some of the inbuilt stress measures with the finite element codes commercial finite element packages have. Okay. So, they said they expected similar errors in case of highly compressible materials such as metallic and ceramic foams, honeycomb, okay, like bones, wood, cotton or different kind of biological tissues. So, what the implication of this study is, if you are using a commercial package, okay, with their inbuilt objective stress measure, then if you have these kind of materials which they have stated, then you can expect that your results will not be accurate. Okay. Even though these stress measures are objective, there will be certain errors, and these errors, if you want to go into more detail, you can read the paper by Baza. Okay. And recently, they have also suggested that the software makers should shift to the TruSTEL stress rate. So, instead of using the Zaumann Green-Nagy stress rates, the software makers should switch to the TruSTEL objective stress rate, which is work conjugate with the Green-Lagrange finite strain tensor. Okay. So, that is what they suggest, and through many examples they have shown that what kind of errors you can get. There are more papers by Baza and co-workers, and you can obviously look into them. Okay. So, Gambi Recio in 2016, he studied the consequence of using the Zaumann stress rate in finite element codes, and he showed that there are many spurious fluctuations in various stress states, okay, when you are using the Zaremba-Zaumann stress measure. Okay. So, again you can go through this paper and have a understanding. Okay. In 2017, Ovchinnikova presented a paper, okay, where they have studied a number of objective stress measures which are available in ANSYS, and they show that there are certain stress measures which are present in ANSYS, but a certain different the results that are obtained can only be obtained by a different stress measure, okay, which is not actually mentioned in their manuals. So, such a kind of reference is made in this particular paper of Ovchinnikova in 2017. So, this paper also I suggest you can read, and there are many papers by Baza and co-workers which detail out the effect of different stress measures. Okay. So, as I said here, as per their suggestion, their observation, the TruSTEL stress rate is the most accurate one, and the software makers should use it. And also in some of the papers they have shown, if you are using a commercial package where the stress measures like Jaumann and Green-Nagy are used, what you can do to compensate, okay. So, they compensate for the errors that might occur because of these stress measures. Okay. So, with this we come to the end of the theory part of kinetics. Okay. So, next we go to some solved examples and try to wrap it up this module. Okay.